Well, good morning. Thank you for being here. It's good to be with you, virtually and with the few people we have here in our sanctuary. This morning I'm going to talk about the Prospering Consciousness. This is our final Sunday in our Journey of the Heart program. I intentionally made the decision not to have anyone else from our congregation share. We are doing everything we can to be safe here. So where to begin with this? As with many things, I look to the scriptures to see what's promised to us there. And so a couple things that really stand out for me from the scriptures are Jesus's words that it is the Father, Mother's good pleasure to give you the kingdom. So right there, that's huge. It's God's pleasure to give us everything that would add to our lives in a healthy, abundant, prosperous way. Also, the statement from the scriptures that I am come that you might have life and have it more abundantly. We believe in the science of mind is that I am is the Spirit of God within each and every person, and that I am promises us that we are to have an abundant life. So I would ask you this morning to think about this. How do you think of yourself? Do you think of yourself as a prosperous consciousness? Interesting, isn't it? Do I think of myself as a really prosperous consciousness? So I want to say right out of the gate that this is not about getting. Early on in my journey into new thought, I thought that it was. I did. I thought that being prosperous was all about getting, that it was about having, and that if I got and I had lots, that would mean that I was actually prosperous. Over time, I realized that was not true. No amount of external stuff added to you can make you feel prosperous if you don't feel prosperous on the inside. Now I understand it's not about getting, it is actually about giving. That I want to see myself, if I want to live my life in this prosperous consciousness, I want to see myself as somebody who always has something to give into life, something of value, something with meaning, something that carries a high-minded intention. You know, I know we've all heard again and again, it's better to give than to receive, and I don't believe that that's true. I think they're equal. Why? Because this is a reciprocal universe, science of mind teaches us. And in a reciprocal universe, as much as you do one thing, you must receive in back, in like kind. Right? So the universe is reciprocal. And the way I think of it is, everything while we are here on earth belongs to God. I mean, face it, it all belongs to God. You come in with absolutely nothing when you were born into this world. You know, although my mother insists that I came in with little luggage packed because I was ready to go from the time I was born. I was ready to travel. And so she says my little hands had little suitcases in them when I came into the world. I don't think that's actually true. So a place to begin for all of us is, do I believe that this is a friendly universe? And the answer for me is yes, it is. It is. But the universe is as friendly to us as we are in the universe, right? Because that's absolutely how it works. There is no place where it's done unto you as you believe more than in the area of money. Now, I think it's the same everywhere, but in the area of money, man, that really gets our attention, doesn't it? Yeah, you can talk about the weather, or you can talk about health, or you can talk about this or that and the other thing, but boy, money gets our attention. Now, our philosophy, the science of mind, teaches us that God has created an abundant universe and that there is an ever-availability of good to all of us, and then that good comes to us according to the law of mind. Okay, so this is really important, that there is an ever-availability of good. This means that God, the infinite mind, has already made the gift. God has already given everything that God is going to give to us, and it now becomes our job to be open, to let go of the resistance, the obstacles, and to be big, gracious receivers in the universe. I say to people all the time, it's your job to be a gracious receiver. And it's so funny to me. I find people have an extraordinarily difficult time with this. People are pretty good about being the giver. You know, we like being the giver. And I'll tell you a little secret. I think the thing about being the giver is you like having the upper hand. If you're the giver, there's a little more, I'm in charge because I'm doing the giving, right? Yeah. But to be able to be a gracious receiver is the other side of that same coin. And I think it's imperative that we all receive whatever anyone is trying to give us, just to graciously say, yes, thank you very much, unless it would be harmful to you, in which case then say, no, thank you, right? But see, what it is, I think, is I want the consciousness. I want to have the consciousness. I want all of us to have the consciousness that knows that our needs will be met wherever we are, whatever we're doing. All of my needs are divinely met. That's one of my favorite things to say. That's an affirmation I work with probably every day and have for years and years and years. And you know, I find it to be absolutely true. I say that every day. All of my needs are divinely met. All of my needs are divinely met. It's an easy one. Say it with me now if you like. All of my needs are divinely met. And over time, that becomes second nature. At least it did to me. And now I say that to myself all the time. And you know, I find that to be true. I find that to be true. How could that possibly be true for every man, woman, and child on the face of the earth? Well, because we are, right now, as spiritual beings, we are one with the source of all good, all love, all supply, all opportunity. See, those things, supply, opportunity, love, they are not outside of us. They are actually inside of us. And what we're doing is recognizing, oh, I have placed the altar outside. The altar is actually inside. And I have to open a way up for this great good of God that is within me to come forward into expression in my life. How much can you accept? See, Ernest Holmes says in the textbook that the taking of God's good is a mental activity. How much can I receive? You know, before I put on the brakes, before I say, oh, that's too much. Oh, I don't know if I deserve any more than that. Another thing I think it's important for us to look at, not only about how much we personally, individually, how much good we can accept, but also when we look out at the world and we see other people who are doing really, really well, and we ask, why do they have so much? You know, because it's a belief they can. I know some people still think that God is up in the sky and that God should divide it equally among everybody. You know, many years back, Buckminster Fuller did this research, and he said that the planet was so wealthy, the planet was so abundant, that if they divided all the resources on the planet equally between everyone who was living on the planet at the time, everyone would have about $4.5 million. But then someone else said later, they looked at this research and they said, yes, that's true, but in about 2 years, all of the money would be back in the hands of the people who had it originally. And that was kind of unsettling to me, but I thought about it and I thought, well, you know, that's because it's really a thing of consciousness. If you have the consciousness of abundance, abundance will be in your life. And if you are the consciousness of lack, you will have experiences of lack. It has nothing to do with God. It has nothing to do with the supply. It has to do with our belief. So people who have so much have it because they believe they can. They believe they can. It's that simple. Why do they have so much? Because they believe they can. And we could just as easily believe we could. You know, I think people have often thought that if I succeed, if I do well, somehow that's going to take away from other people. I don't think that's true at all. We all have a role to play in life, and some of us need to prosper so that we can support and fund other things that we believe in the world. You know, if we resent other people who are doing well, if we're jealous, what we're doing is we're actually giving a message out into the universal mind to postpone our good. We are pushing our good away by that resentment, by that jealousy. Right? Now, what should we say instead? We should say, when somebody has what we want, good for you. Wow, good for you. Thanks for showing me that's possible for me. Thanks for showing me that's available to me. If you could do that with your consciousness, I can do that with my consciousness. See, they have what they have, other people, by right of consciousness. They have done the mental and spiritual work. Now, I know we can do that mental and spiritual work. You know, how good am I willing for it to get, though? That's what we have to ask ourselves, because if I'm really willing for it to get very, very good, that means I am willing to do the work I need to do on a daily basis, the spiritual work I need to do, the treating and the meditating and the affirming and the visualizing and all that stuff. So how good am I willing for things to get in my life? Now, the next thing I want to ask is, what do I personally have to let go of in order for that to take place? Think about that. There are things that we have to let go of, things we have to release. Maybe it's an idea or a way of being, or it's just some clutter in the basement. I don't know. But how good am I willing for it to get? And what do I have to let go of for that to take place? And the last thing, because I think this is connected to all healing, I've come to realize after many years in the teaching, and it's this: who do I need to forgive? For every treatment I do, I ask, who do I need to forgive? Because, you know, little judgments and criticisms and old resentments, they creep in, and before you know it, they're taking up precious real estate that could be filled with much better thinking, with much more productive ideas for all of us. So who do I need to forgive? I want to tell you my very, very favorite money story. When I was young, I had a great aunt and uncle, my Uncle Tony and Aunt Emily. My brother would go to visit my grandparents, and I would go to Aunt Emily and Uncle Tony's. I think I really got the better deal because they did not have any children. My grandparents, they had kids, they were grown, they had lots of grandkids, they were tired. But Aunt Emily and Uncle Tony, they didn't have any kids. So when I came to their house, it was like, oh, our little guy is here. Now, they were really fun people. They were farm people. They had a big piece of land, several acres. And when I was little, I used to follow Uncle Tony around the yard all day long. He was cutting grass or working in the garden or whatever. And they were just these magical people. There was a barn, and there was a milk shed, and grapevines, and fruit trees, and a brook. It was a great place to play as a kid. Now, Uncle Tony would always say to me, remember to save your money. Uncle Tony always saves his nickels and his pennies because he doesn't want to wind up at the poor farm. And I'd never heard of a poor farm. I was just a little kid. That was quite a curious idea to me. So when my dad and mom would come pick me up, I'd say, Dad, Daddy, what's the poor farm? Uncle Tony talks about the poor farm. And my dad would tell me that during the Depression, that there were what they call poor farms. And people would come and live at the farm, and you worked in exchange for a place to live and food and board. And you worked either in the vegetable gardens or the flower gardens or on the farm, and they sold things at market, but everybody had a little place to live and you had plenty of food. And this is one of the ways they dealt with things during the Depression. And my uncle would always say, Uncle Tony doesn't want to wind up at the poor farm. But Uncle Tony was saving money for many, many years to not wind up at the poor farm. And he would always, always say this. So years, years, years go by. Years go by. I go back east to visit my family, and my dad says, we've got to go to the nursing home. Uncle Tony's gone into a nursing home. Oh, I'm so sorry. Okay, so we go see Uncle Tony at this nursing home, and I got to tell you, it's a pretty posh place. It's really nice. The grounds are beautiful. There are baseball diamonds and there are soccer fields, not for the old people, but so that younger people will come and the older people can watch them. And it's just a really, really nice place. So we have a visit with Uncle Tony, and we leave, and I say to Dad, Dad, what was this place? This is a really interesting place. I mean, I've never seen a nursing home with so much beautiful grounds. And he says, oh, when I was a kid, this used to be the poor farm. And I was like, whoa. See, Uncle Tony actually created what he said he didn't want by always saying, I've got to save my money so I don't have to go to the poor farm. Well, Uncle Tony actually had saved a lot of money, and the poor farm had become the highest-end nursing home in town. You know, so this is why it's important to look at, to notice, what am I saying about money? What do I believe about money? Because I believe my uncle created being at the poor farm, only now it was a top-notch nursing home that he wound up paying an exorbitant amount of money to be at for many years. And the great thing was, and this was also the funny thing, is that my aunt and uncle had a consciousness of being poor people. They always referred to themselves as poor people. They lived very simply. My Aunt Emily, anything she wore, they were clothes that she made. Curtains, pillowcases, she made all that kind of stuff. When they died, they were wealthy. They were actually wealthy people. But they never saw themselves that way, so they never really got to enjoy that. So I'm not suggesting to us that we want to pretend to be something that we're not. Science of Mind is not about let's pretend. But Science of Mind is very much about let's create something. Let's create something from within. You know, you don't need to have anything out here to create. It's what you have in here that does the creating, right? I think a piece of this is to always see ourselves as someone who has something of value to give into any situation, whether it's a kind word or opening the door or money that we contribute to something. See, if you see yourself as someone who always has something of value to give, the universe sees you that way as well. I think it's important that as spiritual beings, as people of consciousness, that we have a generous spirit. So I don't know how you see yourself. I hope you see yourself as a prosperous person, as a center of divine supply, a center of divine wealth and opulence, because how you see yourself has everything to do with how God, with how the universe responds to you. Join me in the consciousness now of knowing that today and always, all of my needs are divinely met. Let's pray. So we turn our attention inward now for a moment, recognizing that we are surrounded, we are filled with God's infinite loving spirit. The spirit of truth, the spirit of life is right here. It surrounds us, it fills us. It's the most true and real thing about each and every one of us. And so in this awareness of our oneness with spirit, with truth, with love, I speak the word for each and every one of us that we are embodying, we are up-leveling, we are a prosperous consciousness right here, right now. We are not the consciousness that seeks things. We are the consciousness that creates whatever is needed in the moment, because each and every one of us, we are connected to that infinite source of all good, of all supply, of all opportunity, of all love, of everything we could ever have need of. It's within us. I believe that this is so. And I believe that we are gracious receivers in God's universe, that we open ourselves heart and mind, and we don't hold anything against anyone, anywhere, ever. We are just vessels for Spirit's love into expression in the world. And I know because we always have something of value to give, the universe responds to us as such. We include in our prayer today family members and friends, our parents and children, all of those we hold near and dear. And we know that right where they are, they are surrounded with God's love and light, and that God's abundant supply fills their consciousness here and now. We let our prayer be a blessing in the world that we live in. And so we speak our word for perfect healing for all people everywhere. We claim that everyone's needs are met. We claim peace of mind for all people, and that love is the order of the day. We bless our church, we bless all churches, synagogues and temples and mosques and ashrams, all paths to God. And I'm certain that we are blessed by being together, that there is raising up for each and every one of us. And so with an open, gracious, full heart, I say thank you, God, that this is the truth. Thank you for all of us gathered here. I know only good comes from it. And so it is, and so we let it be. Together we all say, Amen.